One night in early 2019, a woman in China starts feeling a bit sick, vomiting, and hearing a constant ringing in her ears. Deciding that it's best to get some rest, she does what most of us would and goes back to bed, hoping to feel better the next day. In the morning, she wakes up to a bizarre turn of events. She's unable to hear her boyfriend's voice at all. Alarmed, she goes to see a doctor, whose voice she can hear perfectly well. What would happen if you woke up one day and suddenly stopped hearing the voice of the person you love? This is the story of a woman who can no longer hear the voices of men.
Y'all ready for some top fun?
Mav's back, baby.
What? No!
It'll be all right, Grill. Thanks to our video's sponsor, NordVPN, we can get access to movies no matter where we are.
Right.
Access NordVPN on any device from all around the world.
But is NordVPN fast enough to keep up?
It's confirmed by speed tests. NordVPN is the fastest VPN out there. It's as simple as one click. Hey, and if you're more of a tech head, NordVPN has double encryption too. Use NordVPN to shop for plane tickets cheaper like a local and stream geo-blocked content from your home. Your personal data is safe.
Like ghosts.
Not all attacks are physical. Thanks to NordVPN's new threat protection, you'll be warned before you click on nefarious websites, and Nord will automatically delete any malware before it damages your devices. Nord also blocks site trackers watching you across the web. Go to nordvpn.com/brew and use coupon code BREW to get a huge discount off NordVPN's 2-year plan plus 1 month free. This bundle deal is totally risk-free with Nord's 30-day money-back guarantee. That's nordvpn.com/brew. Identified only by her last name, Chen was throwing up one night and not feeling too great. She started hearing a constant ringing in her ears and decided to go to sleep and recover. The next morning, Chen woke up to discover that she was deaf to her boyfriend's words. She couldn't hear or understand anything he said. Seeing how quickly things had gotten worse, Chen rushed to the hospital and spoke with Dr. Lin Xiaoqing. To add to the mystery, Chen was still able to hear the doctor's voice. While she was getting checked out, a young patient entered and, when he spoke, Chen couldn't hear his voice at all. In another example of selective hearing loss, Dr. Neil Bauman had been affected his whole life. When he was only 4 or 5 years old, his dad got the first hint that something might be up. Neil's dad was standing behind him and asked if he wanted to ride in the car. Little Neil loved to go in the car, but he ignored his father's question. Another time, his parents asked him if he wanted ice cream, and he didn't even react. This case concerns not only hearing loss, but also an increase in hearing abilities. Neil discovered that he could hear sounds so faint that others couldn't hear them until the sound energy was multiplied 1,000 times. He could hear kids whispering across the classroom and the buzz of the TV from anywhere in the house, but couldn't hear the teacher talking right in front of him or the voices coming from the television. Things Neil could hear included dog whistles that are silent to most people's ears, a phone ringing in a house across the street, and insects chirping a block away. But sounds like fire truck sirens, a huge 18-wheeler rumbling as it drove beside him, and thunderclaps? Neil didn't register these at all. While we say Neil had hearing loss, his range of hearing was actually huge. It was just different from what society calls normal. Neil actually kind of had super hearing powers. His hearing did change as he got older, and he lost his high-frequency hearing abilities over time. Returning to Chun's case, she wasn't able to hear her partner or the patient who asked her doctor a question during her appointment. The main difference was that Dr. Lin was a woman, while the patient and Chun's partner were both men. Chen had suddenly lost her hearing for low-frequency sounds. Both Chen and Neil have a rare condition called reverse-slope hearing loss. To understand this type of hearing loss, we should understand how hearing works and why we have trouble hearing high-pitched sounds as we age. Sound waves enter the ear canal, making our eardrums vibrate with the different noises. These vibrations continue moving through the ossicles, which are tiny bones in the middle ear that connect the eardrum to the cochlea. The cochlea is a very important hearing organ that contains fluid and looks like a spiral-shaped bone. We have about 16,000 tiny structures or hair cells in our cochleas when we're born. Sound waves make the fluid inside the cochlea ripple, which in turn causes changes in the hair cells. The movement of the hair cells sends electrical signals to our brain, where the signals are translated into the sounds we perceive. Hair cells at the apex of the cochlea transfer low-pitched sound information, and hair cells at the opposite end transfer high-pitched sound information. The hairs break over time, and the ones that detect high-frequency sounds are more delicate and tend to die first. This means most of us struggle to hear higher frequencies as we age. But older people have used this hearing loss to their advantage sometimes. The mosquito is a device which got its name for the buzzing noise it makes, intentionally set at a high frequency that can only be heard by younger people. It's very annoying when played nonstop, or so I'm told. The mosquito is used to prevent younger people from loitering around at malls and other places. It's been playing for the last few seconds. Did you hear it? These devices might also be incredibly annoying to people with reverse slope hearing loss, who struggle to hear low frequency sounds. Remember, Chun could hear her female doctor's voice, but not her boyfriend or the other male patient, because deeper voices have a lower frequency that she became deaf to. RSHL is a disorder that gets its name from the shape it makes on an audiogram, the graph of a hearing test. On the y-axis, we see the hearing level sensitivity for humans. On the x-axis, we see the frequency, or how high-pitched the sound is. For someone struggling to hear high-frequency sounds as they age, the audiogram looks like a slope that goes down to the right. A reverse slope does the opposite and goes up to the right. But not all cases of RSHL are the same. There are three levels or classes of the disorder. In class 1, a gentle slope shows mild hearing loss of low frequencies. This is the most common form of this condition. The range of hearing is about 30 decibels. Class 2, which is rarer, has a much steeper line. Lower frequency noises need to be played very loud before people in this range can hear it. Oddly enough, the hearing becomes normal as the sounds get higher. So while people in class 2 are much worse at lower sounds, they're pretty much okay with higher frequencies. The range of hearing is larger, usually 60 to 90 decibels. The most rare and most curious level is class 3. This is an audiogram of Neil's hearing levels at age 21. There is severe hearing loss in the low frequency side. But on the other hand, there is super sensitivity to high frequency sounds that normal hearing wouldn't be able to pick up at all. The range from the lowest to highest sound heard is huge, over 100 decibels. Out of all the people who are hard of hearing in North America, only 1 in 12,000 of them will have class 3 RSHL. In Neil's case, his condition was genetic. He got it from his mother and had it his whole life. RSHL ran in his family for at least 5 generations. But with Chun, there were no symptoms of hearing loss before the day she woke up unable to hear her boyfriend. While we can't say for sure why this happened, Dr. Lean, who is an ENT specialist, seemed to think it was caused by Chun's lifestyle. She said that low-frequency deafness has been increasing in the past few years, and it's more commonly found in people who are busy, overworked, stressed, fatigued, and losing sleep due to staying up late. Huh. Most of the time, low-frequency hearing loss will be either a hereditary trait or due to ear conditions like cochlear hydrops or Meniere's disease. When it is genetic, the loss tends to be more severe, in class 2 or 3. According to Neil, who is a hearing loss specialist, hereditary low-frequency hearing loss seems to be a dominant gene trait, instead of a recessive gene like most hearing conditions. This means that the children in families with the condition have a 50% chance of having it, and most generations of the family will have this hearing loss. Other genetic hearing conditions often have a 25% chance of passing on, and it can skip generations. There are three stages of RSHL. In stage 1, the hearing of lower pitch sounds drops quickly until around age 5. From then, it's stage 2, where things mostly stay the same until roughly age 50. At stage 3, the condition does not get worse, but people will lose their high-frequency sensitivity due to aging. This means that overall, they become very hard of hearing. RSHL affects the ability to hear lower frequency sounds and is different from sudden deafness, overall hearing loss, or hearing loss in one side. For another case of unusual hearing loss, let's look into the story of Dr. Stephani M. Rose. She did not have reverse slope hearing loss, but a different sudden hearing experience. Stephani was born with what is considered regular hearing, and she passed all of her hearing tests in school. However, she did need pressure tubes in her eardrums to help drain the fluid buildup. When Stephani was in university, she got a call from her sister, who was 19 years older, who said she woke up with sudden hearing loss. A doctor diagnosed her with Meniere's disease. This was the first time that anyone in the family had hearing loss.
I felt like it was fate. I called up my dad and I said, I'm sorry, Dad, I'm gonna have to be in school for 4 more years after my bachelor's because I'm gonna change my major to audiology, and you have to have a doctorate in order to practice and use that degree.
During her first semester of grad school, she learned how to do sound booth checks and was listening to make sure the sound was coming through well when she thought something was wrong with the right headphone. She told her partner, who checked it and said everything was fine. Stephani had felt a little clogged up on one side when she woke up, but otherwise, she was in perfect health. Realizing she had hearing loss in her right ear, she went to her doctor immediately. The doctor said that Stephani was having a hearing emergency and only had 30 days to get the best treatment possible. Stephani rushed to see an ear physician, who gave her medication to reduce the swelling in her ear. With treatment, Stephani was able to recover a large amount of her hearing over time. She continued her medications to manage the swelling, which was made worse by sodium, so she also cut back on salty foods. Though Stephani managed her hearing from that point on, she still struggled when her hearing loss fluctuated. Having hearing in only one side can make life difficult and dangerous. People need to have hearing on both sides to figure out where noises are coming from, like how our eyes need two images to create an accurate picture and understand depth. Our brain needs information from both ears to create a spatial awareness. With two ears, you know where sound is coming from based on how strong it is on each side. So when her right ear hearing was struggling, Stephani had trouble finding sounds, like figuring out where her phone was when it rang. Stephani tracked her hearing loss and had 9 incidents in her first year of living with it. Over time, the frequency went down to once every few months. Eventually, it dropped to only every other year, usually with a stressful live event or diet change. One time, Stephani was visiting family for Christmas. The annual stress fest of the year. Understandably, this led to a drop in hearing in her right ear. She spent the holiday break eating lots of food and hadn't been watching her water intake and diet as much. And, for the first time ever, she felt a fullness in her left ear. She took medication and went through the same process as her first experience with her right ear. Thankfully, within 2 weeks, her hearing bounced back to normal. Stephani also discovered that Meniere's disease was not quite the right diagnosis for her or her sister. They actually had cochlear high drops, which is closely related. This is a condition affecting the inner ear, where there is an increase of fluid that leads to swelling and can cause hearing loss. If people also experience vertigo, then the condition progresses to Meniere's. Everyone with Meniere's disease has some kind of high drops, but most cochlear high drops patients do not progress as far. If they do, it takes about 1 year to develop. Often, these conditions only affect one ear and can happen at any age, which is why Stephani and her sister had their initial symptoms at different ages. The conditions can also come on quickly. People will wake up to notice their hearing is different, or try to listen to their phones or headphones and realize they suddenly have less hearing sensitivity. It can be a reduction in overall hearing, or a loss in one side. On the occasion that Meniere's or cochlear high drops leads to RSHL, it will usually be the class 1 level. Both conditions are chronic, and the hearing loss may come and go over the years, especially in the beginning. The cause of cochlear high drops and Meniere's disease is not fully known. Common conditions that seem to play a role include abnormal immune response, genetic predisposition, viral infections, allergy triggers, and issues with fluid draining in the ears, like we saw with Stephani. Steroids can be prescribed to recover the hearing in some cases. A low-sodium diet is recommended to prevent the swelling in the inner ear. Medication is given to increase blood flow to the ear and prevent episodes of hearing loss. If the cause of the condition is a viral infection, antivirals will help. With treatment, the conditions are both manageable. Cochlear high drop symptoms tend to lessen and even go away with time. With Meniere's disease, though episodes will fluctuate for years, most people will eventually have some permanent hearing loss. As for RSHL, the cause is often genetics, but could also be anything that changes the fluid pressure in the inner ear. Otosclerosis, a condition where there is bone overgrowth in the ear. A complicated case of childhood illnesses like measles or chickenpox, autoimmune disorders, blood vessel problem, or ear trauma can also trigger RSHL. But none of these causes explain Chun's case in China. Autoimmune conditions affecting the inner ear can cause balance issues, which leads to vomiting. Though Chun was throwing up, neither her or her doctor mentioned balance issues. Most likely, the cause was a combination of factors, including the lifestyle pressures Dr. Lin noted. If someone has RSHL due to genetics, it will usually be noticeable from a young age, because while children with hearing loss can quickly learn to lip read, they will be unresponsive when they can't see the person speaking. Fortunately, this disorder has no other conditions or complications associated with it. You may be surprised to learn that most people with RSHL speak perfectly well, as many people who are deaf or hard of hearing can have a distinctive way of speaking. Unfortunately, this also means that people with RSHL have a hard time convincing others that they are hard of hearing. Imagine someone telling you they're almost deaf, but they can hear you whispering from across the room. With other conditions that may lead to sudden hearing loss, there are more symptoms. Signs of cochlear high drops include tinnitus, that sounds like a ringing, buzzing, roaring, whistling, or hissing sound in your ear, short-term hearing loss, and a feeling of fullness or pressure in the ear. Meniere's has the same symptoms, but also includes dizziness that lasts from 20 minutes to several hours, which can cause nausea and vomiting. It's best to catch any sudden hearing loss within 48 hours for the best chance of recovery. RSHL can be diagnosed by a hearing care professional or audiologist by using a hearing test. They will look for hearing losses, but excellent speech, poor speech reception without visual help, and sensitivity to high-frequency sounds. To detect high drops, an electrocochleography or ECOG procedure or an MRI can be used to look for increased inner ear pressure. Doctors will also assess the symptoms and perform hearing tests. Hearing tests will determine how well you detect sounds at different pitches and volumes and how well you can separate similar sounding words. With Meniere's, balance assessments will also be done. These can include tests that study eye movement, track changes in the affected ears, see which part of the balance system you rely on and which are causing issues, and look at how the inner ear responds to sounds. Overall, it's unlikely that you'll experience sudden hearing loss of specific frequencies, but if you do, catching it early is the key. Generally, as long as people don't ignore serious signs or issues, things will be okay. Chun did the right thing by going to a professional quickly, and her doctor was confident that she would make a full recovery. Hearing and hearing loss are a lot more complicated than we might think. People aren't divided into just hearing and non-hearing, but into a whole crazy world of experiences in between. Like me, for example. I seem to, be going through a sudden hearing loss right now. If anyone asks, I'm totally deaf to phone calls, knocks at the door, online notifications, and you know what? I'm just gonna make a list.
Go to nordvpn.com/brew and use coupon code BREW to get a huge discount off NordVPN's 2-year plan plus 1 month free.